Students, I am Dr. Naveen Kumar Jha, Associate Professor in English, RAGS College, Ahilya Sthan. Today I am going to deal with George Herbert as a poet, who has composed so many religious poems, including Virtue, that we have been discussing. We know that his main interest area has been metaphysical theme to talk in his poem, because he is a priest who wrote poetry in Greek, Latin and English. And as you already know that the metaphysical school of poetry has always been making the reader alert against the earthly vices and virtuous deeds in one way or another way. This school has been making us know religious sentiment, religious idea, religious purpose of life, as a matter of fact, because metaphysical is just like not physical, it is above physical, it is beyond physical. And we should notice that it is very hard to understand the metaphysical theme, because it does not have any concrete nature. We know that it remains into the abstract form, and it is just to understand by our deeper experience of life, understanding and deeper concept of theory that you are forming after living the life. But one thing is clear, that the poet, being the religious spearhead, has always been just making his prayer through poem. Now he has also been giving a space of his doubt that he has about the subject matter that he's undertaking. He also presents or offers his devotion to God. He also talks about the suffering of human being from religious point of view, the essentiality of faith, love in his poem. You know, these are the subjects which are not so easy to understand. And it is through the religious experience that we may realize what the spiritual experience is. Yes, we can talk a lot, but we can experience only when we live the life with all seriousness, or when there is certain kind of suffering in our life, we actually just go closer to the super existence of some power which you don't know. So in this particular poem, yes, it is a kind of favor that he's making about the virtuous soul. He's just lighting on the significance of virtuous soul, because it is the only thing which remains after the life is over. So we may observe here the poet's formal innovation and the rendering of Christian faith. You know, religion itself is the matter of faith, and thrust. And we believe, or our belief is formed only when we go through lots of struggles of life. It has been, as a matter of fact, the consequence of our experience that we find. And the poet also, after studying so many beautiful things that the earth is gifted with, the virtuous thing, virtuous soul, and it is a comparative study of the beautiful things which are here on the earth and the virtue that we develop by our deed and by our worthy life. We can see that it has been just the matter of a logical and convincing explanation that the poet is making. He is making to make us know, not by sermon or any religious teaching. I don't think that this poem is a religious teaching that George Herbert has written with any kind of religious purpose, because he has driven the conclusion logically. It is the logical argument that he is making. It is the logical inference that he has taken into account for composing this poem. So we must say that he is always just making us convinced by just a kind of logic, a kind of reason, a kind of syllogism, and a kind of day-to-day observation of the phenomena taking place here. Now, about the poem, we can say that it is a very much lyrical poem, because the four lines of the stanza have their definite purpose. You know, the first line is always going to refer to the beautiful things, say, sweet day, sweet rose, and sweet spring. The second line is all about the traits and the significance, or certain kind of comparison to make us realize how beautiful they are. The third line is just the starting of our sorrow, or it is an indication that coming to the last conclusive line, we are mentally prepared to accept the conclusion. So the third line is just simply making us mentally prepare that something is happening, just with a view to give us know that the thing is no longer existing, and thing is not going to exist any longer. You know, so some people may see certain kind of didacticism, that the poet is didactically talking, but I don't think that it is any kind of didacticism which has been forcefully presented here. Yes, we can say that it is the matter of belief. It is the matter of our agreement with the argument that poet is making here. The poet is not leaving us with no option but accept his feeling or conclusion. I can say, no, it is not the intention of the poet. The poet is just making us think in the way that he has written, he has felt, he has experienced. And so we find that it is music, and it is melody, that each line is written in the same pattern of all the four stanzas. And so even from the content point of view, we can say that there is the similarity of a theme which is coming in each line of each stanza. And we find that from just construction point of view, the word is just set in the way that it creates a kind of melody and music. And from the content point of view also, the same kind of pattern has been made here to go on. So at both level we find that we are in the world of music. We are in the world of melody. And when music and melody are created on both level, on the contents level or on the structure level, we are just simply very much pleased to read that kind of poem. Now, another important point that I should mention about the poem is its simplicity of language. You know, the purpose is so serious to serve that let people understand the value of virtuous life. So, if this grave purpose is presented into the grave language, it will be much more problematic for the people to understand this thing. So, he has chosen very simple language to present the very serious purpose that the poet is to deliver. So you find that from the diction point of view also, there is no such complex words that we need to go to dictionary to find out the meaning again. Or we can also say that even the simplest words have been chosen in diction part, that the idea is just very lucidly coming to the reader. When language becomes cumbersome, we are just not collecting that impression that poet wants to create. So the poet's intention is to make us purify mentally, spiritually. So for that thing, there should be a continuity of idea. And it should go on without any obstruction of language. So he has rightly decided to make the language simple, that the very complex idea of significance of virtuous life is to be interpreted. So you find that it remains a very simple language, and it is very much intensity that the poet is expressing. Intensity is enough. Just endeavor that the poet is going to make for us realize. It is his intensity of belief that has come out, you know, through the poem. And we find that he is not thoughtfully writing this poem. It is not by, yes, experience is thoughtfully made. He has made the observation very thoughtfully of all these things. That he has studied, you know, the beautiful things, including the sweet day, sweet rose, and sweet spring. Yes, it is the long experience of these things that the poet has made, not for 1 or 2 hours, but for many seasons, that he has come to this kind of realization. So, to write this poem, the poet must have spent much time. We cannot say that the poet has sit to write the poem and in a single sitting he has just taken down everything as the thing has come out to his mind. I don't think that it has been the process, mental process of writing this poem. Rather, I think that he might have just studied first what the sweet day is and what the sweet day is meant for and what the sweet rose is meant for and what the sweet spring is meant for. You know, he must have just seen the very much the changes, seen very much the things taking place, and then finally he had concluded this very kind of thing. So what you find is the thing that he had the intensity of thought, intensity of feeling that is just very much poured in this poem, and with a spontaneity of just expression. That once we are sure of presenting our idea, it spontaneously comes out. We find that when we are not clear from the experience point of view and from the observation point of view, what is to say, it becomes a little bit difficult to give the spontaneity to that kind of thing. When our emotion and feeling and ideas are well clear, we can say they start flowing spontaneously. So the poem is going to be seen from that angle, and no doubt it is very much a religious fervor that has been just in the back of writing this kind of thing. And that is very much the duty of the priest like George Herbert, to write something out of the religious fervor. You know, it is just simply to make man uplift from the higher grade to highest grade. We cannot say that it is just to explain, to make one follow any kind of doctrine of religion. Just the main purpose of the priest or the poet, age of religious fervor, is to make us purify our life, make us beautify our life, make us feel our life beautifully. And for that, we should be duty bound from religious point of view as well. And when you are duty bound, to make one upgrade from just higher level to the highest level, we find that religious fervor is automatically realized. So the poem circulates the idea that virtue is supreme and superlasting. This is what the conclusion of the poem is. But to reach this conclusion, he has just studied a lot. And we cannot say that in a single breath we can say someone that virtue is supreme, and people are going to admit this kind of thing. People are going to admit the thing when we are making them realize the significance of that thing. We are going to make them feel that it is in this way that it has been important. Saying something to do this kind of thing is not making people do that kind of thing inwardly also. So we can just circulate our idea, but it should be circulated in the way that it should be very much transmitted to the reader very lucidly. And so to make it do that kind of thing, he has taken the images, you know. So it is rightly chosen image that the poet has used. And we can say the images are of beautiful things that we all understand. You know, it is not only the poet's conclusion that sweet day is beautiful, or sweet rose is beautiful, or the sweet spring is beautiful. Universally, they are just taken as the beautiful things. And so, when just these images have been made here, that on the one hand, they are all beautiful things, but on the other hand, you find that they are short-lived. You know, they are bound to decay, no matter how beautiful they are. Now then, we are just little bit disappointed to see that this is what the end of even the beautiful thing is. Then what is the purpose of life? We begin to think on another front. If the beautiful things are just going to decay very short, in a very short span, now what is the importance of this life? This life is also very beautiful, no doubt. But how to make this beautiful life live longer than it should be? It is not going to be physical alive, that is not. No, otherwise, physically, a spring was also alive, just sweet day was also alive, and so on. So they are just going to finish themselves with the physical existence. Till they have the physical existence, they are charming on us. We are attracted by all these kind of things. But if we are talking about all these things beyond the physical existence, we can say that no, once just they are physically dead, there is no further just a thing to spread. But here, what is the human life about? What is the human life about that should be alive even after its decay? It should be alive even after decay because of the virtuous soul that we are just going to make. It is the virtuous action that is always going to give a smell, or it is the sweet smell that is always coming even after the physical existence is over. We cannot say that it is up to the physical existence that they are going to live. So only virtue is eternally existent. We can say that it is eternally existent and it just lives beyond generations. So here the poem has blending of thought and feeling and unification of sensibility and learnedness. So we can say that the poet has unified sensibility and learnedness, because learnedness is coming all from the logic that he has used to write the poem, and sensibility that he is sensible enough to realize, to experience the beauty of rose, the beauty of nice day, and the beauty of what he can call a spring. Now, likewise, you can say that here there is unification of thought and feeling. It is after the this thoughtful process that he has just come to this kind of conclusion, and feeling was always religious. So these things have been unified very clearly in the poem by the images like sweet day, sweet rose, and sweet spring. And it is all to assert his point. He is making it assertive. You know, he is just going to make his conclusion assertive by putting the instances of these images that he has created here. So sweet days are eaten up by dark night. Sweet rose has sweet color, but it is also not going to live forever. And once again, the thing time is coming. Its fragrance is faded up. It is going to be withered. And spring too has so many things, including music and color, but it is slumped, or it is prone to the olds. But what about the virtuous soul? We cannot say that all these external factors are working on the virtuous soul. As night has been the very much responsible factor to eat up day, but what is the thing that can destroy? What is the destroyer of virtuous soul? There is no destroyer as the night is the destroyer of day. We find there is nothing that can destroy virtuous soul. There is no force which is more powerful to destroy just the virtuous soul, because there is no contradiction of existence. We can say day and night are contradictory existent. They cannot live together, and they are cyclically coming and going. We can say likewise the season is contradictory existent. When a spring is here, okay, then it is moving towards the next season, summer, and then it is going towards the next season, because it is time oriented. It is a matter of time, and time is the most destructive factor. When the time is gone, just a spring is gone. So when it is the time of night, time of day is gone, no matter how beautiful it is, how nice it is, how sweet it is. But here we can say that the virtuous soul is not eaten up by any time. There is no contradiction for the existence of virtuous soul. It is just living without contradiction. So here season is living with contradictions, because one season is just coming at the cost of another season, and they are natural cycle which is bound to take place. It is why they are living just shortly. They do not have any way of expansion of their life. But we cannot say that there is any kind of contradictory relationship to realize if we can say that we are just talking about virtuous soul. So yes, we are ourselves destroying our life. We are not just following the virtuous lifestyle. Naturally, we are following vicious lifestyle. You know, so it is in our hand. If you are following the virtuous lifestyle, the vicious lifestyle is never coming. It is not coming to eat up. You know, it is why just Jesus was always worshipped, because he has never let, you know, vicious thing to come in his life. He has always just support, or he has always followed what virtuosity is there, and it is why his life has been so supreme, and he has been living here for many regions. So I can say that we are just going to make here over, and I think that you must have come to